Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me? Hello, good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Let's give a minute for a few others are joining. We'll get started. So far, I see Vishal, Akesh, Abhidhi, Chaitu, someone on iPad, one on iPhone, Kumar, Mamta, MG, Rishinda, Stephen. All right, good afternoon, everyone. Can you still hear me clearly?
Yes.
Okay. Start sharing the screen.
अच्छा उधर से
मेरे 30
मैन
या होर
कितने यहाँ पर टोटल
टोटल से 50
ओके गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन Welcome to this session on SAT test prep. This is primarily meant for parents. It gives information about the scope of the test. And when can you take it?
Where are you being? I never connect to your hotspot, but that is not the
If you have a high school going child and if he or she wants to be there, that's fine. They may get bored because we're not going to actually go to any class or anything, but it is primarily for parents, but your children are welcome to stay on. But if you are a child and if you are by yourself, probably you should call your mom or dad. They will find it more useful. Please, Can everybody stand mute? Most of you are. I just muted or just joined. Okay. Looks like many of you are new to Mavis Academy. I'll very briefly, just one slide, talk about what is Mavis Academy, but I'll primarily spend the first half of the presentation on what SAT is, when and how to prepare for it, when to take the test, etc. And any questions, what is the structure of the test, how many questions will be there, how many points will be there, and all that. How is the scoring done, etc. In the second half, I will talk more about our classes, our online coaching for preparing for SAT. And we'll also talk about our coaching methodology, coaches, schedules, fees, etc. Okay, if you have any questions, you could type into the chat. I'll keep the chat open on the side. Yeah, I did mute everyone, but I think anybody joins new, it doesn't automatically mute it, so I have to go and mute them. All right. And you can ask any questions anytime, just type into the chat box, that may be the easiest way. I'll keep it open. So what is Mavis Academy? We are an educational academy based in Atlanta, Georgia, but we are online academy. We used to have on-site centers in Atlanta until last year with the pandemic, converted everything to online now. We are in operation since 2011. We do a number of activities, providing information related to test preps for high school going parents of high school going kids, coaching them, as well as we provide coaching for younger kids on math, English, science, coding, spelling, etc. for typically first to eighth grade kids. Our goal in all of them is to help bring the best out of every child. And we do our best to in that mission. Apart from the online courses, we conduct many webinars like this on a number of different topics. We also conduct sometimes various online sessions like Read a College prep seminar a few months back. We did a few Fun with Math sessions during the summer, spring and summer, etc. So, but this presentation will specifically focus on SAT prep. So what is SAT? I'm sure all of you know, in different aspects. So it is a standardized test that can be taken by any high school student. There's with some exceptions, a few middle school students, talented middle school students may take it. I'll talk about that later. It is conducted by an organization called College Board. It is an independent nonprofit organization based in Princeton, New Jersey. And so they help conduct the test. The scores are obviously used by the universities for college admission purposes, but College Board is an independent organization. And they conduct a few other tests as well. They also are the ones who conduct advanced placement or AP tests for high school students. That provide the college credits. When the kids go to college, they can actually earn credits while they're in high school. So that's the purpose of AP subjects taken in high school. It's the same organization that conducts the tests as well. Okay. So what are subject areas covered in SAT? Again, as most of you may be aware, it comprises of math and English. So the English again has a reading component, what they call evidence-based reading, and writing and language, which is more grammar. So it's not really, you actually don't write anything in the writing section of SAT. There is a separate essay, which is optional. I'll talk more about what optional really means and whether one needs to take it or not. So the main English section that comprises reading and writing. So the writing part in that is really analyzing the writing and no understanding grammar, identifying mistakes, etc. And the reading is comprises of passages. These are typically college level passages, and one needs to understand and address
questions.
Okay, so just turn the mute. As I said, at any time, if you have any questions, feel free to type your the chat. For those who joined, we're just getting started and just explaining what SAT is. We haven't got into the meat of the presentation yet. Assuming most of you already registered, so we'll send the presentation after this, but also feel free to if you haven't registered, if you, maybe somebody just forwarded you the link, you type your email address. You can actually send type into the as a personal message if you would like in the chat, and make sure we'll send the presentation for all those who attended. For those who most of your names I can see. A couple of you with iPad, iPhone, or short description. Would you mind changing, actually put your name? So I'll try to make it interactive, address questions, but it'd be great if you can write your full name. And Sridevi is also there in the session. Sridevi is our student success manager. You probably would have received emails from her. So after the session, if you have any follow-up questions or if you want to register for the classes, etc., Sridevi will help with that. Either Sridevi or me. So how does this SAT score look like? Now, most of you probably are familiar with the 1600 score, right? That 800 in math, 800 in reading and writing combined. Essay, as I said, is optional and hence it is graded separately. Essay score is not part of the main SAT score of 1600. So let's talk about what optional essay means. So it is really up to the colleges on whether they would want to need that score or not. So it varies from college to college, and even within a college, some majors may require it and some majors may not require it. Now, most students will apply for multiple colleges, right? In the senior year of the fall of the senior, fall and winter of the senior year, they will apply for the colleges. At the time, they typically apply to 68 colleges, and some with major, some you can leave it as major undecided. So because you're not sure which colleges are applying for, I would generally recommend to apply to write essay as well, unless your student absolutely knows which colleges he or she is going to apply and which majors. And all of them, they do not require essay. You can always go to their website. Each university maintains an admission page, and you can check there whether it is required or not. They also give median SAT score. They never give max or min SAT score. They give a median SAT score of the past students. Okay, so essay is graded on a total of 24. And three different parameters, each parameter 8 and 8, 8 and 8. Essay, by the way, is the only one which is manually graded by human beings, by actually anonymous English teachers in different parts of the country. And the two teachers who actually grade every student's essay, and the score is the sum of their grades. Everything else in math, reading, and writing is machine graded. It's scanned and machine graded. So most of them are multiple choice questions, which makes it easy to machine grade. In math, especially, there are a few non multiple choice questions, what they call as grid-in questions. So the students have to fill a grid. So the actual number is a, actual answer is a number between 0 to 1,000, 0 to actually 9,999. Maximum four digits. It can be a fraction or a decimal, but they have to actually shade the number with the grid. And based on that, the machine will grade. So essay is the only part which is manually graded. Any questions on the scoring so far? Okay, so now, how is this 800 score determined? It's not that there are 800 questions in the test. Actually, math has 58 questions. Reading, writing have different questions. Together have about 94 questions. And so it is not that the score is a direct translation from the actual number of questions that are answered. What SAT does is it takes the actual raw score. So the number of answers correctly answered are called raw score. They take the raw score and they put it on what is known as a normal curve or a well-known bell curve in statistics. So the score ranges from 200 to 800. So the max is 800, mean is actually 200, it's not zero. And typically the median is around 500. So this is where, this is not necessarily the mean score, this is the median, meaning about 50% of the students get less than this score and about 50% more than this score. It doesn't have to be exactly 500. It can vary from test to test depending on the its difficulty, but generally around, it falls around 500. As you get up, if you got all the questions correctly in math. So math is graded separate and English, that is reading and writing combined, is graded separately. Within math, if you got all the questions correct, you will probably get 800. Sometimes if the test is very hard and nobody gets all questions right, even if you get one question wrong, you might still get 800, right? It really means that you are in the top probably one percentile of the all the students who took the SAT in that particular test, right? And as and depending on your actual score, it will be graded. So that is what it really means when you got 800, 700, 500, 650, that it really gives a relative score with respect to all other students who took the SAT at that time. It is not an absolute score. So math is graded separately on 800, 200 to 800, and English graded separately on 200 to 800. The essay, as I said, is separately graded. And while signing up for SAT, you can choose whether to opt for or opt out the essay. Generally recommended for high school students, it's recommended to take just because some colleges may require it. Now, sometimes there is an exception in terms of who takes the test. Some of the seventh and eighth graders, highly talented seventh and eighth graders, also take it for Johns Hopkins University offers a program called CTY, Center for Talented Youth. And they might take in seventh or eighth grade, and more their essay is not required. But if you take for high school, it is unless you have a specific question, please stay on mute. Even question you can type into the chat. Or I will pause between the slides. At that time, you can unmute yourself and you can ask. Any questions on SAT scoring so far? All right, let's move on. So let's look at the structure of the test. So there are four sections in SAT, excluding essay. So essay as an optional is a separate section. So it always goes in this order. The first one is always reading. or evidence-based reading, there are 52 questions and you get 65 minutes. So you get a little bit over a minute per question. Then writing and language, 44 questions and 35 minutes, a little bit less than a minute per question. So you might wonder why reading has more time than writing relatively per question. The reason is, for reading, by the way, of all the sections, generally most students, even the highly advanced students, find reading probably the toughest section. Because here, the passages are given. First, the student has to go through the passage. And typically, these passages are college-level passages. They come from different topics. Some come from science, some come from history, some come from literature, etc. And so one needs to read the passage, then read the question. And some questions will be like a main idea question or a question that you can address if you understood the whole passage and the author's viewpoint. So the whole point is you actually have to read it from author's viewpoint. And for, so these main idea kind of questions you can answer right away. And some questions will be specific to a specific line in the passage. So they actually give the line number. So after reading that question, the student needs to go back to that line number, reread that part, probably a little bit above and a little bit below as, that line number as well, and then answer the question. So it's a much more intensive process. It definitely requires more time per question, but it is also probably the one that needs the highest amount of concentration and focus. Because you read, sometimes the passages are pretty long and you read, go back to question, then go back to passage and read. Writing and language, on the other hand, are mostly grammar type questions. So if you're pretty good with grammar, you will probably be able to answer just by reading it once. But we'll cover all of this. If your student is going to attend our classes, we'll extensively go through what kind of passages come, what kind of questions come. We'll do a lot of practice throughout the course. So sorry about that. I went ahead. And then math has two sections. There's one without calculator and one with calculator. The math without calculator, it has 20 questions. So it is a section 3. Because they always come in the same order. Section 3 has 20 questions and 25 minutes, a little bit odd, 1 minute per question. And math with calculator has 38 questions and 55 minutes. And essay, 50 minutes. So if you opt essay, you'll have additional 50 minutes. A total of 154 questions per plus essay. For a total of 3 hours and 50 minutes. Now this is the actual test time. Now you will also be given breaks between the sections. And it's always on a Saturday morning. It's at around 9 o'clock. So I'll tell you why it's say around 9 o'clock. So the student needs to be report by 8 o'clock. Then the students will be let in, put it in their respective rooms. Proctors will be there. The proctor, and then you will be given a time to read the instructions, etc. So the proctor will give the test. So the proctor will time each section. So they'll generally give around 9, but even if they give a few minutes later early, it doesn't matter because they time each section. And you cannot go back after you finish a section, or finish reading and you go to writing. When writing starts, you cannot go back to reading. So you have to finish one section and go to the next section. So the total test will be well over 4 minutes. And the total, the student will be typically be there for about 5 hours because you go to 8 o'clock, there'll be a lot of other students right nowadays. You also maintain social distancing. Even within the rooms, they may now they give much more distance between students. So all that takes time. Now, as you can see, it is not just a test of intelligence or test taking, it is also a test of endurance. So you have to sit for literally 5 hours and you're taking test for close to 4 hours. So please make sure your student sleeps well the previous night. In fact, make sure he or she sleeps well previous two nights, right? Any preparation would need to be done far in advance. There's no last minute, no need for last minute cramming into the late nights, right? It's not just what you get to the last minute. And the tests are fairly predictable. So SAT always follows a predictable pattern. And that's why these are highly coachable. It is a highly coachable class because if you take reading, writing, math, RSA, it always follows a particular pattern. And if you understand what kind of questions come, how to answer them, how to time yourself, how to manage the time, it's very predictable. Any questions? So who is this course? So primarily, as we said, it's for college admission. 9th to 12th graders, it can take any time of the year. But for 12th graders this year, it will be too late, right? Because they'll be applying right now. So typically by 11th summer, latest unit to finish. Then worst case, you can take early fall of the 12th grade, but that's better to avoid that. You don't want to get into last minute rush. You can take any time during the high school. So many students take in either 10th or 9th grade. You can also take it multiple times. So the colleges take the highest of this course. And some colleges also do what is known as, let me make sure it's recording. Yeah, I'll send the recording as well as the presentation for all those who, where we have emails. Let me double check the recording. Yep. Yes, so my recording will be sent. As well as the presentation. And how many times can you take? So you can take as many times as you wish, but my recommendation is to take probably 2 to 3.
Videos are not available.
Even if you are in the 9th grade or 10th grade and you take the SAT and you got the score that you want, you don't need to ever take it again. But most students take 2 or maybe 3 max. You can take more physically. There's nothing that stops you from taking, but I think you would lose seriousness beyond that. 2 is very common, 3 is okay. Okay. Many students take in the 9th or 10th grade. Many students actually finish by, nowadays many students are finishing by 10th grade, but 11th grade is absolutely fine. So what are the other purposes for which SAT is used? Many scholarships also are based on SAT scores. Either solely based on the SAT score or it is one of the requirements. So, and for some scholarships are also based on what is known as PSAT, which is taken in the 11th grade. You can also take in the previous times, but 11th grade what you take as PSAT. Also has some scholarships, but there are hundreds of scholarships. Now, talking about scholarships in general, in this country, most scholarships are what are known as need-based scholarships. Those have nothing to do with SAT scores or PSAT scores or anything. They're purely based on the need. And and if your income is beyond a point, you will not get those scholarships. But there are many other scholarships. You may not heard as much, but there are a lot of scholarships. which are purely merit based, and for many of them SAT is one of the requirements or sometimes the sole requirement. So that is another reason why you would want to get a good score in SAT. A third reason is for 7th or 8th graders, there are certain talent identification programs. The most popular one is Johns Hopkins CTUI, Center for Talented Youth. There's one called UKTIP, but they are, because of the pandemic, they're affected and they may not be offering it. But Johns Hopkins CTUI is still being offered. And this is not necessarily for all middle school students, for those who are, you know, very talented and well ahead of their grades, they can take SAT or ACT and then and qualify for this. There is another question about SAT versus ACT. I'll come back and address that question. I think Bhanu and Suma both asked that question. Okay, let me finish SAT part and then I'll come back to. Actually, I think, yeah, so we're entering the pandemic part. So let's address SAT versus ACT. So ACT is another test which is offered, and most colleges, in fact, almost every college take both SAT and ACT. So it's really based on the student's preference. The main difference between SAT and ACT is in terms of the time per question. ACT is much more time constrained compared to SAT. So you'll have less time per question. And so the other one often is SAT is a little bit more critical thinking focused versus ACT is more typically like school-like. And but it's also more time constrained. So if your student is extremely fast and always maintains the time, maybe ACT is better, right? The ACT, you could, you get a relative advantage if you're good with time management. But if you tend to run out of the time or don't have enough time, SAT is better. But both are accepted by colleges equally. Same for CTY as well. CTY also accepts both. There is another question by ABV. If you're unable to take the SAT for CTY because of the pandemic this year, will you be able to take the test in eighth grade? Yes. It is applicable both for 7th and 8th grade. You can take in either 7th or 8th grade. Okay, any other questions? Another question from Manish. If you take both SAT and ACT and scores less than one of them, does it reflect on the profile? No, you can actually decide which scores to set. The colleges look at whichever score that you report, and even within that ACT or SAT, if you took multiple ones, you can decide which score to send. And having got lower score in another one doesn't impact your profile in the eyes of the colleges. From scholarships, do colleges prefer one over the other? No. Again, all scholarships accept both. There's some scholarships which are based on PSAT in the 11th grade. And those are based only on the PSAT, not the ACT. And the PSAT, by the way, is exactly the same structure as SAT. So it is the same syllabus, same level of difficulty. It has slightly fewer questions. And a slightly lesser score, it is 760 in each subject instead of 800. So a total of 1520 instead of 1600 in math and English combined. But it has the same syllabus, same level of difficulty. So if you are, let's say you are in the 9th or 10th grade this year, which means that next year, and it's always in October. So next year, next academic year, your student, is going to be in 11th or 10th grade, they will take PSAT at their school. And if you want to prepare for that now, Yeah, if you whatever you're preparing for SAT is perfectly sufficient for PSAT as well. So those scholarships are based on PSAT, which is SAT based. But otherwise, both are fine. Any other questions? So there is a private question of us may not be able to read. Hello, I missed a couple of slides and presentation, please. Yeah, all those who, one thing is I do not know who would have attended. If you actually can type all, each of you, if you don't mind typing your email address in the private chat.
Test cancellation.
And also.
Any test get canceled.
And also if you can.
Test at the college board in the fall, winter. So, made the test optional.
Vishal, is that
you just made the test optional.
Vishal, you are not on mute. Okay. So for emailing the slides and link to the recording, please type your email in the mailbox. In the chat box, private chat. Just select the Wellness Academy and type it over there. Okay. All right. Next. So now there are many questions about the pandemic. One, because of the cancellations. Two, some colleges made it optional. So I'm sure many of your questions related to that. So let's talk about that specifically for this year. So more college board is actually added more tests during the fall and winter to make up for those who are those who could not take. This probably impacted especially those who are in senior year this year. By now they probably would have taken. So more tests were added in September and October and November. I think by now most seniors would have, they have to catch up because by December, they would be completing the all applications. If you're doing early decision or early action, you apply early in the fall. If you're a regular application, probably by December or so. Each college has slightly different dates. They would have probably caught up by now. Now, what does it mean? Some universities made the test optional or not required, especially University of California system. That is the probably the biggest system. So if you are applying solely for University of California system, you wouldn't need SAT or ACT. You may still need it for the purpose of scholarships, but for college admission itself, if you're only applying for University of California system or tests are not required, you wouldn't need to take SAT or ACT. But for most students, I think they would still need to take mainly either for the scholarships, right? And second is typically you would apply for multiple colleges. So even if you live in California, you may be applying for a few other colleges outside California, those colleges might require. So you would need to look at which colleges you would be applying and what kind of scholarships should be. You should apply for scholarship, as many scholarships as possible. Scholarships in this country are, the more you apply, the more likely you get. So it takes time to apply and research and apply, but the more you apply, more you like, and you can take multiple scholarships, right? If you get one, it doesn't mean that you can't take another scholarship. Some of them might be smaller amounts, some of them may be larger amounts, but you can take as many scholarships as you can. Somebody has a question, how long is this class? Do you mean this session? This session is until between 3 to 3:15 we should be done. Let me record the time. Should be done by around between 3 to 3:15. So if you're asking about the actual class, SAT class, I'll talk about that in a couple of slides. So, okay. So at this point, I'll switch over to the classes. Our SAT, ACT and PSAT classes are offered for 7th to 11th graders. We're starting a new batch from December, around December 5th. Exact schedule, for those of you who are interested, we'll work with you on the schedules. It'll be twice a week, 2 hours per session. So it'll be 4 hours per week for 12 weeks. It's a 48-hour class from December all the way through March. So this is for ideal for those who are taking March test, but even those who are taking a little bit later in May or June can still take attend this class. We also have many other classes. I won't spend too much time on those today, but if you have younger students, especially first to eighth grade students, we have critical thinking math classes called Math Genius, school math called Math Core, we have ELA. By the way, especially the Math Genius and Language Genius together are a great foundation for future SAT and PSAT, ACT, etc. So if you're younger students, it will also help with building capabilities now that will help with the school in their respective states, but it will also be a great foundation for later on when they take SAT in high school. We also have public speaking courses, spelling, vocabulary courses, science, coding. Most of these are available as small group courses, typically 6 to 8 students. SAT maximum we keep 6 to 7 students, some others may go up to 8, but we all keep all the small group classes. We also offer one-on-one. So if you prefer one-on-one coaching, if you know that your students are learning type is, you know, works best in a one-on-one setting, we offer one-on-one classes as well. Obviously, they'll be slightly more expensive. I'll talk about all the fees at there. Another question that came in the private chat, will you be touching on subject SAT test? Will there be coaching for subject SAT test? I won't talk too much about subject SAT test today, but if you do want subject SAT test, yes, coaching, we do offer that. So for just briefly, for those, most of you probably know, subject SAT tests are, depending on which college and which major you're applying to, the colleges may require certain subject SAT tests, or sometimes known as SAT2 tests. They're specific to math, chemistry, physics, literature, etc., depending on which major and which college you're applying for. We offer those as well, if any of you tell them that. We also offer any AP courses, AP or any high school course for that matter. If you need, your child is taking biology honors, or if your child is taking AP physics or AP calculus or any of the high school subjects, we offer most of them as one-on-one, because we find that especially in high school, they're talking about a specific AP subject or honors subject or regular subject, they would need specific help based on what the school is teaching. And so group classes won't work for that. So whereas everything else, including SAT, because you are taking a one standard test, right? Group classes work fine. But in any school specific courses, like AP honors or regular courses, we do typically one-on-one. Any questions on, I'll talk more about SAT course in the next few slides, but if you have any questions on any other subjects, for if you're a younger student, you can email us. You can email sridevi@mathsacademy.com. My email is, so I'll type both of our emails here. My Sridevi's email is sridevi@mathsacademy.com, which probably all of you have, because you probably have received emails from her. My email is math.academy.com. And you can follow up with us for any questions. Any other questions before I move on? Talk more about how our SAT courses. Okay. Let's move on. So what's our coaching methodology for SAT? Now I'm talking mostly about SAT because we get much more requests for SAT. If any of you require specifically ACT, we can help with that as well. So cover all subject areas. So if it is SAT, math, reading, writing, essay, we cover everything. We cover the concepts as well. So most students probably already know most of these concepts, but we cover it from a perspective of SAT, how it looks like in SAT, what kind of questions come. So we go through those concepts as well. These will indirectly help with the school as well. Right? We don't focus just on the test alone. All the primary goal is preparing for the test. We also want to make sure that the students actually understand and retain those concepts. We obviously talk about test strategies in multiple choice questions, for example, when to eliminate versus when to solve the questions, how to manage the time, when to use calculator, when not to use calculator, how to address reading questions, how to manage time in reading, which is typically where probably the most time constrained. So we'll do a lot of test strategies, practice. We'll do a lot of practice. So after every class, the student will get a homework. Sometimes, now, if you're teaching a specific concept, we give homework related to that. Sometimes we give a particular section of SAT. Sometimes we give a full test. So during the course, they will take several full tests. Now, all these tests and practice has to be done outside the class. The 48 hours I mentioned is actual interactive class, live interactive class. We provide all the material required, including the tests, and they would take these tests outside the class and submit their response to the teacher. All these are live interactive classes, max 6 to 7 students in any class. And although these are group classes, these are small group, we pay individual attention and observe how the students are doing. Any questions on the coaching methodology? So the next, who are our coaches, right? So we have been doing this for a long time, 9 years now, and we tried a number of different types of coaches. We find the best coaches for especially SAT, but some of the other coaches as well, but especially for SAT, ACT, PSAT, etc., are those who took SAT themselves during their high school days and got perfect or near perfect scores, but also very good at explaining to others. And so typically they do, they're currently doing undergrad at prestigious universities. We take only the best of the best, the top, probably 0.5 to 1%. We take through several layers of filtration. And then over a period of time, we take the best of the best. And then they go through training before they actually coach any of your students. And most of them have been coaching over several years. We take only with those who are experienced. So it is knowing SAT or being able to get a good score in SAT is different from effectively teaching SAT. So those who got experience in teaching others, they were also passionate about it, right? That is another, in fact, for all of our classes, one thing common is we only take those who are very passionate about whichever subject they're teaching. And both highly qualified, but also highly motivated themselves, because those who are motivated can motivate others. If you're not motivated, and that's why we find many of the school teachers may not be suitable for this, because they're not looking for this, those who want a job, right? Those who are passionate about it and motivated. And also ability to connect, emotionally connect with the students. In fact, we find that these kind of coaches are the best in connecting, because they themselves went to high school in this country relatively recently. And so they know what the test looks like. It's not just, you know, how tough is the test or what the concepts are. It's also it's, as I said, it's a test of endurance. So being able to put yourself in their shoes and take them along is important. A few questions, Chaitu, how many students will be in class? Said maximum six to seven students. Sometimes it could be a little bit lower, but more than that, we'll make separate batches. Will there be any makeup classes if the student missed the classes? Will the weekly homework be graded? So we record all the classes. So the students will have access to the recording of the class as well as the material after the class is over. So if anyone misses a class, they have the recording and the material. In fact, even if they don't miss, if they just want to review it one more time, the recordings are available. Or if they miss, let's say, first 10 minutes or last 10 minutes because something is there, they always have the recording available. Stephen, how long per session per week? So it's a twice a week and each session is 2 hours. So it's 4 hours per week times 12 weeks, that's how 48 hours sessions come. So it's 2 hours per session and twice per week. Will the weekly homework be graded? So yes, but not in the traditional grading sense. It is more, so we have the homework submitted in a Google form. It goes to the coach in a spreadsheet. It is for the purpose of seeing how they're scoring and what kind of question they're getting wrong and to address. So we don't grade it like a traditional school. We won't go on step by step, but all this, the responses go into a Google Form spreadsheet. The coach reviews that and occasionally provides the feedback, but also looks at the score, how they're scoring over a period of time. We do multiple tests throughout the duration. So we can track their scores as well. Does it make sense, Chaitu? And any other question from anyone? Banu, do you have multiple sessions per year? For example, summer. Yes, we do have multiple sessions per year. Throughout the year, we make multiple sessions. And sometimes we have multiple sessions going in parallel, right? Because we keep maximum 6-7 students in a session. So we often have 2, 3, or 4 batches going, but we're still limited by the number of high quality coaches that we can have. So it's not unlimited, but we have multiple sessions going on in parallel. Currently we are planning 2 sessions from December. They both are partially filled. But yeah, we do offer in summer as well. What days of the week are session offered? So we haven't finalized the exact dates and times, but one will be during the weekend, one will be during the midweek, so that they're reasonably spaced with at least 2-3 days between each class. And they're in the evening. They're in evening around 7. They start around 7 or 7:30 EST. So if you're in West Coast, it may be 4 or 4:30 PST. So keep in the late evening so that it should not conflict with other school activities, etc. Next question. Mamta, who are the coaches? What are their qualifications, experience in this? So that's what I just talked about, Mamta. The coaches are those who got perfect score themselves in the past during their high school days, and they went to high school relatively recently, because the city keeps changing every few years, every 10 years or so. So they got perfect score themselves, and they got admissions to prestigious colleges. So they went through the whole process that your child will be going over the next few years. And they're typically doing their undergrads at prestigious universities. But again, not every undergrad. They take the top few percent, top probably 0.5% of them, and they go through rigorous training as well as filtration process. before they actually teach the students. Will they be taught on all the four years each class? No. So that will be too distracting. We'll probably take one subject first, let's say math, or reading or writing, one of them. And we do it for a few classes, then switch over to the other. As the test date nears, we cover all of them more frequently, but in the beginning, one at a time, so that we don't switch too often. But during the 48 hours, 12 weeks, we cover all of them multiple times back and forth. Initially, finish one subject, go back, and toward the end, we'll spend more time on all of them together. But they do have to take the full tests, which are outside the class. Sometimes after the first class, typically we'll do one test, which is like a diagnostic initial, how they're doing initially. At that, so they have to take it after the first class. At that time, they will go through all of them. So when they're taking the test, they did not go through all the subjects yet. That is okay. The goal is just to see where they are. It also makes them more self-aware. So the test will be, whenever we do the full test, it will be all the subjects. But the classes, we do one at a time so that you don't switch between the subjects too often within a class. Any other questions? Banu, how are you different from other test prep providers? So we are a boutique. We are not like a mass scale factory. We are very, very selective in our coaches. I personally monitor all the classes. We keep track. I and Sridevi are accessible throughout. So Sridevi keeps in touch with all the parents. If you have anything, any questions, anything, maybe even, so we also give informal guidance for the parents. That's probably our biggest differentiator, because we treat it like a family affair. And SATs, our college test preps, are really like family affair. So we get to know not just the student, but also the parents. And so if you have questions on maybe while taking the test next year, what kind of APs to take, etc., we'll be happy to share our perspective. So our goal is really to help, as I said at the beginning, of those who are there from the beginning, get the best out of every child. And we are accessible, not just the teacher, but our student success manager and I are accessible if you need any, if you have any questions or need any help. When does the station start? So it will start roughly December 5th. We'll come from the exact date and day, depending on which days we are doing. The next few days we'll finalize that. And we'll work with you. For those of you, if you're considering, please let Sridevi know immediately after this session. And we'll also work with you. We'll have probably multiple batches anyway, probably two batches at this time. So we can find the current, the time that works for you. So please do let Sridevi know right after this if you'd like to register. Next, how many tests do the kids will be taking? Probably around six full tests. We can give more. We have a lot more tests. It really depends on the student as well, because each test is about 4 hours, right? 3 or 4 hours there to find a time to take. So we average around six tests. Any other questions? Okay, let me go to my next slide, but I'll keep answering the questions. Schedules and fees, I think this is the question many of you are asking as well. As I said, twice a week, and each session is 2 hours, total 4 hours per week. It'll start, so our current batches are ending by December 3rd, because there is a test on December 5th, and we'll start right on that day or right after day after that, and that will go until March. And the fee is $1,080 for the full course, which roughly comes to, if you divide 1,080 by 48, I think it is $22.50 per hour, which is by far the most competitive anywhere you will find. So that is another, I guess, the differentiator. If you look at typically SAT classes are anywhere from $40 to $50 per hour. So these are, this average $22.50 per hour. And includes the material. You provide all the material. You don't need to buy anything. The tests, they can take any day, any time, because they'll be doing at their own pace at home. Yeah. So it's not tied to the class. It has to be definitely done outside the class. So they can take any day, any time at their pace. Yes, we cover essay writing as well. Yep, absolutely. What is the structure of the class? So the structure varies slightly as we progress. In the beginning, we cover more of the concepts. Again, when I say concepts, not necessarily boring the students, because they know some of these concepts. It's more a concept from the viewpoint of how SAT looks at those, right? And then we give homeworks related to that, we cover one subject at a time. As we get closer to SAT, there will be more practice. So we also look at how the students are doing. So sometimes during the class, we might have them actually do, especially things like reading, need to observe how they're doing the class, and then based on that, the coach fine tunes there. So the structure is somewhat flexible. We observe the students, and based on that, initial part will be more conceptual coaching. As we get closer to the test, more test strategies, more observing the students, and feedback, etc. Stephen, after the March test, when is the next one? Will there be another test during summer as well? Yes, there will be several actually. After March, I would probably recommend the next one June, because April and May will be busy with the school exams, right? Especially if the high school students, they might have AP exams in May, etc. So the next ideal one will be June, and there will be some in during the summer, and we'll have separate batches at that time as well. Our next batch probably start in March, if that's what you're asking, targeting probably the June test. And then for those who want to take later, they'll be again in August, September, etc. Next academic year, so we'll have some classes for those. Any other questions? I think I'm mostly done with the presentation. Yeah, this is the last slide. Most of you probably already registered. If you're interested in the classes, if you're already in touch with Sridevi, or even if you're not, you can email one of us or both of us. Or if you haven't registered, if you only registered for the webinar but not the class, but if you're interested in the class, you can go to this link. It is also there in the email that Sridevi sent. You can register over there, or you can just email us. Or please do, if you're emailing us, send your number as well. You can also call us. I can provide our numbers. I'll enter my number here. Sridevi, would you mind entering your number? I don't remember offhand. Just call her. But, if you want to talk to me, this is my number. I'll call on that number. I think some of you are already speaking to Sridevi. You probably have her number. It's not here, so don't remember Shri Devi's number offhand. But you can email us. Any other questions? Sure, Nathan, got it. Okay. Send a private message. All right, there are no other questions. I think we're at 3:05 Eastern time. We did pretty good on time. Have a good rest of the weekend. And I hope the session is useful. And if you have a student who's going to take SAT soon, let us know. We'll be happy to help. Bye.
Bye, thank you.
You're welcome. Bye.